Lord, as we do so and prepare our hearts, listen to the word of the Lord from Titus chapter 2, beginning in verse 11. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Let's stand as we sing to the Lord together this evening. Reached for me and pulled me from a raging sea, and I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. My hope is hidden in the Lord. He proves each promise of his word. When winter fades, I know spring will come. Is my salvation. In times of waiting, times of need, when I know loss, when I am weak, I know his grace will renew these days. The Lord is my salvation. Like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. And when I reach my final day, will not leave me in the grave, but I will rise, he will call me home. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful. My salvation. Glory be to God the Father. Glory be to God the Son. Glory be to God the Spirit. The Lord is my salvation. Spirit.
our salvation. The Lord is our salvation. The Lord is our salvation. Of Zion, we will sing with our hearts restored. He has done great things, we will say together. We will feast and weep no more. We will not be burned by the fire. He is the Lord our God. We are not consumed by the flood. Upheld, protected, gathered up, we will feast in the house of Zion. We will sing with our hearts restored. He has done great things, we will say together. We will feast and weep no more. In the dark of night, before the dawn, my soul be not afraid, for the promise morning, oh how God of Jacob, be my strength. We will feast in the house of Zion. We will sing with our hearts restored. He has done great things, we will say together. We will feast and weep no more. Every vow we've broken and betrayed, you are the faithful one. And from the garden to the grave, bind us together, bring shalom. We will feast in the house of Zion, we will sing with our hearts restored. He has done great things, we will say together. We will feast and weep no more. We will feast in the house of Zion. Our hearts restored. He has done great things, we will say together. We will feast and weep no more.
Amen. You may be seated.
We look forward to that day, and until that day comes, we have a stewardship, and that's what our text will be about this evening before we go to the Lord together. Father, we do thank you for the celebration, the joy of the consummated kingdom to come. We thank you that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that will be revealed to us. We thank you for that. We walk by faith, knowing that that is true. And we pray that you would help us. us to be faithful in the moments that we live throughout our lifetime. So, Father, the search committee, we continue to pray for their work. We thank you for those who have committed to the time involved, and we pray that you, by your Spirit, would lead them, guide them. We pray that a candidate would surface as you would bless our process that we see as in good order. We pray that you would bless it and that a candidate would surface that would serve us well. Now, Lord, we ask your blessing on your word, our time together in it. Make it rich, I pray. Cause each of us to consider personally what this text means for us. As we know what it means, as we will see what it means for your church, help us to see and think individually of the application of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Turn, if you would, to Matthew chapter 25. And I'd like to read the passage, verses 14 through 30. You are probably familiar with this being called the parable of the talents. That's what it's called. There's a heading in my Bible. That's not a inspired heading, but the New American Standard ones who put this together have put some headings just to help us find our way through the scriptures. And it's called the parable of the talents. And it's not talking about a talent for playing guitar or singing or whatever you're good at. It's talking, the talent actually is a measure of weight. We'll talk about that. It's talking about money that is given in the story to servants, to slaves. Verse 14, Matthew chapter 25. And Jesus, this is the context, he's talking about departing, being ready for his coming. There was the parable of the virgins with oil just before this in chapter 25. And he says in verse 14, "For it is just like a man about to go on a journey." And context, the kingdom, the coming kingdom. It's just like a man about to go on a journey, or the consummation of the kingdom, who called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, each according to his own ability. And he went on his journey. Immediately, the one who had received 5 talents went and traded with them and gained 5 more talents. In the same manner, the one who had received the 2 talents gained 2 more. But he who had received the 1 talent went away, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. Now, after a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. The one who had received the 5 talents came up and brought 5 more talents, saying, "Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me. See, I have gained 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Also, the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, "Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one also who had received the 1 talent came up and said, "Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. And I was afraid, and I went away and hid your talent in the ground. See, you have what is yours." But his master answered and said to him, "You wicked, lazy slave. You knew that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have put my money in the bank. And upon my arrival, I would have received my money back with interest. Therefore, take away the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more shall be given. and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away. Throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Perhaps you've been in the position of the master, where you have given someone under your care or under your authority a job to do and a time to do it in, and have come back sometime during that period and checked on their work. Maybe more likely, you've been on the other end of that. You've been given a job to do and had your work checked on. I remember giving children chores and checking on those. And, you know, we all have done that or been on the receiving end of someone checking up on us. Well, this parable focuses on the behavior of believers, or at least professing believers in one case, while waiting for Jesus' return. And its lesson is primarily twofold. That while Jesus is away, the believer is to do something. That is, to be active. To work faithfully and diligently with whatever has been given to him for the master's interest. Okay? It's about him, his glory, his will. So what has he given to us? How would we equate talent to us? Well, we could think of the wealth of the kingdom, which would include the truth of the gospel that we understand. It would include access to God and the ability to pray and receive answers to prayer. It would include the opportunity that you have in your life because of the circles that you're in, because of the positions that you have in life. It would include the resources that God has given you. Now, that could be money, but gifts, maybe abilities thrown in there as well. But mostly these are things given to us in our salvation. So the gospel, the truth of the gospel, access to God, the opportunities once we're saved, could be with family, with friends, with neighbors, co-workers, etc. The ability to be salt and light with all the resources God has given. So while Jesus is away, the believer is to do something. And while Jesus is away, the believer is to know something. That is, his work will be greatly rewarded or severely judged if found to be unfaithful. So a real question to ask ourselves: what resources do I have? Help me, Father, to identify them. As we go through this passage, help me to think about them. And am I being faithful? Help me to answer that question tonight as we go through this text. By the way, I mentioned I would tell you about it. A talent was a measure of weight. The resource I had said 75 to 80 pounds. So that's a heavy amount of gold or silver. So just some, I'm not sure which translation it is. One of them translated as bag of gold. It might be the NIV, I'm not sure. But as a way of getting our minds around what this was, here you go, invest this for the benefit of the master. So the value of the talent would differ based on whether it was gold, silver, copper. But the idea here is great value. So again, I want to encourage you to realize God is giving you, given me, things of great value. The truth of his word. And we have a special stewardship in a part of the world where we can read and where we have copies of the Bible so easily. So the truth is something that we should cherish and feel a responsibility for. It is one reason why a Nicholas Piotrowski wants to help train people in ministry. It's one reason why Mike Christ is doing that in a place where they don't have enough adequate training of men in the scripture. And so he is taking what he has been given, a good mind and opportunity to study the scripture, and taking that overseas, just a couple of examples. So God has given us things of great value, the truth, the word, the prayer, the word of God, the prayer and prayer, and then opportunities in our lives because of the circles we're in, maybe wealth, giftedness, abilities can be, of course, used as well in kingdom work. But mostly these are things he gives to us. That's what the parable is presenting. He gives you the bag of gold. What is this? So maybe not that natural sports ability you grew up with, although he may show you how to use that to run a basketball game, okay, and to bring glory to him. But whatever you have, he wants you to use it. He wants you to invest it for his glory. In the parable, the wealth was his, and what was gained from it came back to him. So he is central, using it for him. So let's see the significance of this parable step by step. In this parable, number one, there, by the way, the outline is in the bulletin. Number one, the Lord foretold his departure from the earth. That's one thing that's happening in this area of the book of Matthew, in this discourse of Christ. Verse 14, for it, the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven, is just like a man about to go on a journey. So Jesus is saying that he is like the man traveling to the far country. And indeed, he ascended into heaven to sit at the right hand of God and has yet to return. So recognize then that this parable is our encouragement and also our warning today, because he has gone to a far land and he has yet to return. And we have a stewardship while we live on this earth. Number two, the Lord entrusted his possessions to his servants. Really, we need to think of this as slaves. That's what the word means here, is the word doulos. Verse 14, he called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. One he gave five talents, to another two, to another one, each according to his own ability, and he went on his journey. Notice some things here. Notice that the Lord called his own slaves, verse 14. He owns us because we were bought with a price, 1 Corinthians 6:20. We are his slaves, his bondservants. And I believe God uses that strong a word to make us realize that we are to serve him. We're not independent creatures. I mean, we are in some sense that we have freedom of thought and so forth, but we are not to think of ourselves as believers as independent from our Lord. We're to think of ourselves as waking up each day with a master to serve. He owns us. We are his slaves, his bondservants. We are to serve him in life. Isn't that what the parable is suggesting to us, the teaching of Jesus here? That we need to think of ourselves as a slave while he is at the right hand of God. Notice also in verse 15 that the Lord gave each a different portion of his possessions to look at. No one was left out, and all were expected to work and to serve. So no one in the room tonight, or anyone who would listen to this, should think, well, I haven't been given anything. That's not true. You have the word of God. Prayer to start with, and that's why I keep emphasizing those two things. You have the Holy Spirit to work in and through you. So you are rich indeed if that's all you can think of. Thirdly, the Lord gave to each according to his own ability. Four things here. No two servants have the same ability and opportunity, but Jesus knows what our ability and opportunity are. Second, the Lord gives his possessions. Again, truth, access to God, prayer, position, opportunity, circles of influence. He knows all of that. All of it comes together. He gives his possessions as he wills, knowing each servant perfectly. Third, each servant receives all he needs and can use. And each servant has equal opportunity to be faithful in using what God has given. And we are judged on our faithfulness, not the size of the work assigned to us. I hope you heard that. We're judged on our faithfulness, not the size of the work assigned to us. God called me into the pastorate, but that doesn't mean my work is weightier in value than the work of one of our Sunday school teachers or the work of one of our members committed to prayer. Each of us will be judged on faithfulness to what we have been given, to what Jesus wants us to invest in. Now, I think a great lesson here that I want to mention before I go on is that Christ has made every necessary provision for his church while he's gone from earth. In other words, he's given us what we need to invest. We have it. And he is building his church from his right hand of God through the Spirit, blessing the work of his servants as they invest in the kingdom. All right, number three on the outline. The servants treated the Lord's possessions differently. That's what we find in the story. Immediately the one who had received the five talents went and traded with them and gained five more talents. In the same manner, the one who had received the two talents gained two more. But he who received the one talent went away and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. So we see that two servants were very responsible. They were faithful and diligent. They used their abilities, their opportunities, their energy, their resources immediately, verse 16 tells us. One had more to work with, but both worked equally hard and equally well. And they were successful. That's the second thing we notice about the responsible servants, slaves. Each doubled what the Lord had given him. Each one bore fruit in proportion to what he had received. Then we see one servant was irresponsible. He simply did not use what was given to him. Instead, he buried the money given to him. And say this carefully, that's how some act with their, and I'm going to say quote unquote, Christian life. They neatly tuck it away somewhere safely, or perhaps we should say somewhere comfortably, out of view of others within the circle of their influence. I think that's one good application of this servant. And we will find, I think you know, we will find that he is not a true believer, but an unbeliever. So there's something wrong when you come to this point in the parable. There's something wrong if that's you, okay? If you're like the irresponsible servant. Now, we should all be challenged by this. We can all find ways that we're not being responsible enough, but irresponsibility, one question you would have to ask yourself, if this doesn't resonate in your heart that I want to be a faithful slave to the master, if that doesn't resonate in your heart, then we need to talk about being saved and coming to Jesus as Lord and Savior. But the lesson here is clear in 16 through 18. Use what the Lord has blessed you with. Time, money, position, opportunity, knowledge of the Word of God, prayer. Use what the Lord has blessed you with, no matter how great or small it is. immediate, diligent work will bear fruit, and that fruit, no matter how great or small it is significant to the Lord. We see that in what comes next. The day of reckoning came, verse 19. Now, after a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. I think it is significant that Jesus says that it was after a long time. It seems to us a long time to wait for his return. And so we see this phrase and we can identify with it, after a long time. Be faithful during the time. Do we expect Jesus to come in our lifetime? Well, we don't know. The Bible tells us to know that events can certainly happen as God would will them and come together, and things will happen in his time. But just be encouraged that maybe not, because it's after a long time. And I don't mean, don't think of the immediacy, the possibility of immediacy of his coming, which Paul seems to indicate in some places. So the healthy attitude is, come, Lord Jesus, I'm ready for your coming, but I'm also ready to keep working till I die. Does that make sense? Because there have been a lot of believers, those who lived during, let's say, Civil War, World War I, World War II, and who were up in age, might have very well thought, this is leading to the coming of Christ. This is an upheaval. Look at the world. And they died. And others have been born and died. And so the healthy attitude is, every day I wake up, I'm going to be a faithful slave to the Lord. And it may be our lifetime. Even as we pray, come, Lord Jesus. So it was after a long time. Secondly, notice he had a reckoning with his servant. And I think it's important to understand the truth in Scripture that professing believers will give an accounting to Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Now the issue for the believer is not heaven or hell at that point. The issue for the believer is one of rewards, as we see in that passage in 2 Corinthians. But there is a day of reckoning. So Jesus, as he talks about coming back to check on these slaves, we should take that to heart. Fifthly, the Lord commends the faithful, verse 20. The one who had received the 5 talents came up and brought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me. See, I have gained 5 more talents. And by the way, he's presenting these to the master. It's his. The 5 were the master's, gave them to the slave to invest. The slave made 5. Well, they don't stay in his account. No, they're given back to the master. We serve him for him. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. So you see the two-part commendation here. You'll have more responsibility and you'll have joy. Verse 22, also the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. So the reward for work well done will be the master's commendation and the honor of more work to do. And doesn't that help our understanding of the kingdom to come, the consummation of the kingdom, the new heaven, the new earth? We think of it in terms of worship. The book of Revelation gives us that picture. We think of it in terms of rest, as we should. We think of it in terms of the presence of God, the glory of God. maybe we should also, well, yes, we should also think of it as work for the master. But work for the master in a perfect way. What, I mean, if you enjoy serving the Lord, you will enjoy this verse, knowing that there is more to be given to you in the kingdom to come. Now, what exactly that means, I don't know that we can spell that out, but it's more than worship and rest. It's work as well, and it will be perfect and be joyful. So notice some things here in these verses 20 through 23. They both acknowledged God's gifts and graces. You entrusted 5 talents, you entrusted 2 talents to me. They acknowledge it was from God. And all that was accomplished was due to God's gift. So they're acknowledging his grace. They both had a testimony of fruitfulness in their work. I have gained. What are examples of fruitfulness today? And this is a question for you. Chime in. What are some examples of fruitfulness where we would take this and apply it in real life terms? What is fruit? Your life. Don't flinch, I'll call out. What was that? Proclaiming the gospel and people responding to the gospel. One aspect of fruit that we greatly rejoice in is people converting. If you've had children converted, you were a part of that. You know the joy of that, or a neighbor, or a friend that you prayed for. What else? Good deeds, I heard. And what did you say? Answers to prayer. Amen. And good deeds, of course, means a lot of different things, but certainly we're exhorted in that way. But people converted, people being ministered to, answers to prayer, maturity in your Christianity, your Christ-likeness, so that you bring glory to God on earth, that is fruit. And it may not be people converted, but it might be seeds planted or seeds watered, as Paul speaks about. But whatever, they both had a testimony of fruitfulness of their work. And so should you and I. We may not know all of the fruit. We may not be able to give names to all of it, but God does. Revelation 14:13 says that after we die, our works follow with us. Interesting verse there. I don't think we know all of our influence. All of, when we stand before the Lord, it is likely that we will not understand all he sees as fruit in our lives. Thirdly, in this part of the passage, the Lord commended both, well done, good and faithful servant. They were good, the kind of servants, slaves he wanted them to be. And he commends them for that. Good. And they were faithful. They did the work that he wanted them to do. So notice the twofold commendation there. Good and faithful servant. And then notice that the Lord gave them great rewards. They were given greater responsibility in the Lord's kingdom, and they were given entrance into the joy of the Lord, into his kingdom with all its blessing. And this for slaves. You need to realize how surprising it is that the kingdom and the joy of the kingdom is for slaves. It just didn't happen in the real world. But Jesus wants us to understand how we should see him and how we should relate to him as our master. But he wants us to understand he is a master who will bless us immensely, unlike earthly masters. All right, then number 6, the Lord punishes the unfaithful. The one also who had received the 1 talent came up and said, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. And I was afraid and went away and hid your talent in the ground. I just want you to notice as I'm reading this how self-centered, how creature-centered this unsaved slave was. That he would be afraid and think only of himself. And he hid the talent in the ground. See, you have what is yours, as if that was enough. Really, in this statement, he is covering his disobedience and laziness. But that was because of, we would say, understanding it from the point, our viewpoint of the scripture of salvation. It is an unsaved man. His master answered and said to him, "You wicked, lazy slave." What did he say to the ones who were faithful? Good and faithful, but now it's a condemnation. Wicked, lazy slave. "You knew that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed." But the other slaves were doing it for his glory. This slave doesn't do that. "Since you knew that, you ought to have put my money in the bank, and on arrival I would have received my money back with interest. Therefore, take away the talent from him. Give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away. Throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." So I think Christ, it seems to me, he is speaking of a professing believer but a false one. I think that's how we should interpret it in the balance of Scripture. So note the excuses for not using the resource, the gift that the Lord had entrusted into his care. He accuses the master of being hard, verse 24. That is, one who expects more than he has a right to expect and who profits from the labors of others. And I would say to this one, well, yes, he's the Lord. And we are to bring glory to him. That is why we are here. That is a primary reason we have been created. But he accuses the master of being hard. In his view, that's being hard. And he was afraid of losing some of the master's money, and that's self-centered because he would have to come up with money on his own. So afraid of losing what he was giving, he justifies keeping it safe and offering it back. And then note the reasons that the Lord condemns the servant. Verse 26, the servant was wicked rather than good. The servant was lazy rather than faithful. And the servant was dishonest. For if the servant really believed what he said about the master, he would have at the very least gained interest on his master's money. He tries to excuse himself, I think we are to see here, by attacking the character of his master. In truth, he is not devoted to his master's interests. That's the point of this third man. And then note the judgment. The unprofitable servant, he was stripped of what he had been given. He was to have nothing else to do with the Lord's work. His responsibility was given to one who was faithful. And of course, don't miss that being faithful, certainly Jesus sees that in our understanding of history and can open up more responsibility, more opportunity for those who are serving. Secondly, not only is he stripped of what he was given, he is cast into outer darkness. He was not allowed to stay in the Lord's presence. Note its description in verse 30. The outer darkness, in that place, there will be weeping and gnashing teeth. It is the description of hell that Jesus uses to speak of God's place of punishment for unforgiven sin. He does so, if you want to write these references down, in Matthew 8:12, speaking of unbelieving Jews. And he uses the same description in chapter 22 of Matthew, verse 13, of the man not dressed in wedding clothes. So in context, how do we deal with this here? How do we interpret it for this third person? We interpret it that he is cast into hell. The servant represents a false believer. It's evident in the lack of fruit, It's evident in the lack of understanding of his master. It's evident in the attitude expressed, fear and rationalization rather than humility. And it's evident in the judgment that is given. What's the lesson of the parable? Well, let me quote D.A. Carson, who summarized it this way, and I thought this was good. Here's his view on the lesson of the parable. Wait for Jesus as slaves committed to improve our master's assets. Wait for Jesus, he's been gone a long time, in our understanding of time, as slaves committed to improve our master's assets. If there is no investment of your life for the glory of God, Jesus, for the gospel's sake, no service to others, no tithe or offering, no investment of time or energy for Christ, then this parable puts you on dangerous ground and calls you to repentance and true faith. And true faith is always, we see here, a working faith, an active faith. The book of James is one of the reasons that God inspired that book to be in our text, that we would understand that faith is a working faith. The way James puts it, faith has works. If you have a true faith, this is to encourage us in the work that Jesus has given us resources for and ability for and opportunity for. Be diligent, for your work will be rewarded, and it will be worth everything when you stand before the Lord, and you will, and he will assess. Because just as you checked on your son or daughter's room, or just as your work was checked on by an employer, we do have an accounting with him, with the opportunities, the wealth that we've been given, truth, access to the throne, circles of influence. I haven't exhausted all of the wealth, but those things, we will give an accounting of it, and we want to be good stewards. It will be worth everything to hear. Well done. So just as Pastor Madden exhorted us this morning to keep things in the proper place, and you're going to hear that next week too, because the church health essential has to do with contentment. There are things in our life that are proper to be there, but they can never be the main thing, and they should always be seen in light of our relationship to Christ. We are not independent. This parable tells us we are slaves, bond slaves, doulos. Our first priority. It's our only priority. It's who we are, and it's the way we should think about life. And if, let's say you exercise weekly, let's just get practical, and you go to a club to exercise, that's good stewardship of your body. Hey, but look for it to be stewardship of kingdom truth. Seek to engage in conversation. God will use our personalities, who we are. He'll use our divine appointments as we're out and about, but be open to that. You carry with you truth that the majority of the people you see each day do not understand. And you can pray for those people, and you can engage in conversation with those people, and I can as well. And you have resources that can be put toward kingdom work and so forth. This is just telling us, well, we should do that for the joy of it. We should do that for our burden for souls. We should do that because Jesus is worthy of it. But we should also do it because everything we have is from him, and we are his slaves. That's what he's saying here. And it honors him. It brings glory to him. And it brings commendation from him when we see it. So Father, help us to be diligent, because this parable puts us in our rightful place, that By your grace, we have become your servants, your bondslaves. And by your grace, you have enriched us, given us wealth of knowledge and access and opportunity and ability. And I thank you, as I look around this room, I thank you for evidence of faithfulness. But that's just my viewpoint. We answer to you, and we pray that you would help us to see our lives as you see it. Help us to examine, help us to grow in sensing your joy in how we live with what you give us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, God bless you. We'll see you, Lord willing, Wednesday night.